Well, hello and welcome to First United Methodist Church of Gulfport, where our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ. And we seek to do this by doing the following. We trust God, we honor everyone, and we reach out in service. Like so many churches now, we are back in person for Sunday morning worship. But if you're new, if you're checking us out for the very first time, well, consider coming and worshiping with us in person. And to our online and to our televised community, please know that you matter to us and we will be engaging you every single week. I want to invite you to check in with us if you're worshiping online by going to that digital Hey card, click on that link, give us your name, your information. We want to hear from you. Also, if you're on Facebook today, we would invite you to jump in there, make comments, press that like button, and most importantly, share this worship experience with your social media friends. And don't forget to give. It's so important. And we really appreciate all of you who have given to us and have helped us support our ministries. We have many ways that you can give to our church. You'll see those listed on the screen. We have a very special guest today. Tracy Capoletti is our guest preacher. You're going to recognize her. Tracy is on staff. She's our director of discipleship, and she's going to preach for us today. Tracy is in seminary, which is a school that trains people to become ministers, and she's in the middle of a preaching class. And so I've asked her to share the sermon today, Easter People. So she's going to share a story, another one of those stories where the risen Christ appears to the disciples. Listen closely, because she's also going to talk about how the risen Lord appears to us today. Look, we live in a chaotic time, but the blessings far outweigh the challenges. And so take a break from any distraction, and let's together give thanks to God for all that God has given us. Our worship now begins.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Forever, if the Lord's the Lord of them, and a friend will not say never, 'cause
Will you pray with me? Loving God, as Easter people, we give you thanks for the risen Christ. We know that through his resurrection, when our burdens are too heavy, Jesus is there to take them. All we have to do is trust you. Our beautiful, beautiful world is hurting, Lord. We ask you to be with those in these times. Cover them with your healing mercies and your grace. And we ask you to be with those that we keep so close to our hearts. Help us to move from the path of selfishness and stubbornness into the channels of hope and peace. Keep us strong and give us the courage to serve you in all that we do. And now we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hi, everyone, and thank you for worshiping with us today. Today, we continue our series on Easter people. And I just wanted to say that I am so happy to be sharing in this message with you today. Will you pray with me? Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Every year in my hometown of Salem, Virginia, the city hosts an annual children's fishing rodeo. And I can remember as a young girl anxiously awaiting this day. From the day the banners went up into the day of the event, I was all in. Now, I'm not exactly sure why. I don't particularly like fishing. I think it's slow and boring. It's a little gross. You have to touch the fish. And also, it can be very disappointing. But nevertheless, every year, my dad gathered up all of our old fishing gear, along with me and my sister, and we would head off for the duck pond. Now, the duck pond is across the street from Burger King. So before settling in, we would make sure to grab some lunch, and then we would go back to the duck pond and spend the day fishing. Besides, French fries make excellent fish bait. I'm not sure if you knew that. So after what seemed like hours of the excitement of every time a fish tugging on our line, or the disappointment of every time a fish stole that French fry bait, we would eventually go home. But first, we would make sure to stop by my grandmother's house with our usually small catch of fish and give it to her, because we don't even eat fish. So what's the catch? Today, in our scripture lesson, we read of seven disciples, a disappointing fishing trip that did turn miraculous, and breakfast on the beach with Jesus. This story comes on the heels of Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. The disciples have been hiding ever since their friend was arrested and crucified, and it's only now that they're starting to break apart and head back to their hometowns, which is where we find seven of these disciples today. Now, let's stop for a moment and talk about the seven disciples that John tells us about. He names only a few of them. He talks about Simon Peter, aka Peter, who was a fisherman, and not just a sport fisherman, but a serious professional fisherman. This guy knows what he's doing. And then there's Thomas, and we learned about Thomas a few weeks ago, and we know that Thomas is intelligent. He's a thinker. Thomas has to see it to believe it. And he also tells us of Nathanael of Cana, who is also believed to be a fisherman. Of these group of seven disciples, they know what they're doing. They know how to fish. So it should come as no surprise that Peter one night decides, hey, I think I'll go fishing, because he knows that the best time to fish is at night, and they decide to join him. So they fish throughout the night, and every time they pull their nets up, they come up repeatedly empty. Talk about a tough break. These guys have lost everything in the past week. And they've been in hiding, and they've had to return back to their homes, and they've had to restart their lives, and they can't even catch any fish to do so. Things aren't looking so great for them. Then, at the height of their despair, they hear someone off in the distance on the beach, and they see someone there. And now, as readers of the Bible, we know that this is Jesus. But they don't have a clue. But he calls to them, "Children, have you not caught any fish?" And like I said, these disciples, they have no idea who it is. In the height of their despair, they didn't even recognize the Lord. So what about us? When we are in our deepest and darkest moments of despair, do we even recognize Jesus? What the disciples do know is that this guy, this bystander on the beach, is referring to them with close familiarity. "Children," he calls them. And not in a degrading way, but in a, "Hey friend, how's it going? Have you caught anything?" kind of way. And they respond to him with a disappointed no. So the bystander on the beach says, "Well, cast your nets to the right side of the boat, and you'll find some fish there." And I can just imagine what Peter is thinking right here. He's probably like, "I have been fishing all night. I know what I'm doing. I'm a professional. Who are you to tell me how to do my job?" But Peter has nothing to lose. So they cast the nets to the right side, and lo and behold, the nets fill with fish. And not just some fish, but a lot of fish. So many fish that they cannot even pull the nets into the boat. And this is when all the light bulbs are going off. The dots are starting to be connected. They realize who this person is. It's Jesus. And this is the third time Jesus has come to visit them in the span of just over a week. In the time of these disciples' darkest despair, Jesus continues to show up for them. So it's no surprise that Peter so excitedly jumps off the boat and swims to shore. Now, it's not far to shore, only about 100 yards that John tells us. But when he gets there, he finds a charcoal fire that Jesus has prepared for him. Now, do you remember the last time we saw Peter around a charcoal fire? It wasn't long ago. It was only about a week and a half ago when we saw him huddled around a charcoal fire trying to get warm while Jesus is being questioned by the authorities. And it's around this fire that Peter denies Jesus, denies even knowing who he is. And yet, here on the beach, Jesus has prepared a fire for Peter. Why? Why would Jesus do this for him? Because Jesus doesn't require perfection from us to have a relationship with us. Because with Jesus, it's about love and grace and forgiveness. And here is where we find my favorite illustration of Jesus. The picture of Jesus sitting on the beach, enjoying breakfast with the disciples, with his friends. Out of all the things Jesus could be doing, he is taking the time to invest in his relationship with them. And then he serves them bread and fish. This is the same life-sustaining food that he served the 5,000 at the Sea of Galilee the last time we were here. And this just exemplifies that Jesus is the ultimate giver of gifts and sustainer of life. You see, my dad passed away this past year to COVID. And as I begin to reflect all of the shared moments we had together, I've begun to realize that it was never about the fish. It was about my dad investing in a relationship with me and my sister. And that's the reason why I looked forward to that day at the duck pond every single year. And with Jesus, it's not about the fish either. It's about the intimate love of Jesus and the relationship that he wants to have with you and with me. Life is full of unknowns. Dark valley and brilliant mountaintop moments and everything in between. And through it all, Jesus is there. Even when we're not perfect, even when we don't recognize him. And when we trust that Jesus is with us, we can find peace. We can find peace in the mundane, peace in the joyful. We can find peace in our darkest and deepest moments of despair. So this week, I challenge you. I challenge you to find that peace, to know and to remember that Jesus is with you. Because through it all, Jesus is relentless and persistent in investing in a relationship with us, providing us strength and sustenance for the journey forward. Amen.
Like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
As always, we want to thank you for worshiping with us. We hope you have a wonderful week. And join us next Sunday at 10 a.m. for online and televised worship. I'm going to be preaching again on this sermon series for Easter called Easter People. And we're going to be looking at the book of Acts, the story of Stephen the martyr, and how the Holy Spirit was able to work in his life. If you want to learn more about our church, then please visit our website. And remember, life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind. And may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.